Okay, so what we're doing is a brief introduction both to IPA and the book. I'm going to start more with IPA, so I'm guessing people will be coming into this session from a range of backgrounds. I'm going to give a brief introduction to what IPA is. Then Isabella is going to move into more to do with the mechanics of actually going through the process, and we'll be illustrating some features from the book as she's doing that. Okay, so what is IPA? Interpretative Phenomenological Analysis. IPA for short is an experiential qualitative methodology. And the reason I'm saying that is people are probably aware of this, but I've been doing psychology for quite a long time now, and there's considerable changes through my career. So when I started, there was very little qualitative methodology, and it was probably enough to say I'm a qualitative psychologist. You can't just say that now because there is this range of methods and you need to define the particular one that you're doing. And IPA is an experiential one because it is actually concerned with experience. There are other qualitative methods that have other focuses. The more specifically, what IPA is concerned with is getting at personal lived experience. That is the major things that are happening in people's lives. Experience in itself is quite a wide span, so that we can talk about experience being something that's fairly mundane, just walking down the street, not with any particular intent, but because you want to get somewhere. At one level, that's an event which is a human experience, but it's not an experience of great significance. IPA is concerned with experiences which are more marked, where it has an impact on the person. They take stock and they attempt to make sense of it. So from a psychological perspective, the sense-making is a key part of it. And the experience and the sense-making, the meaning-making that participants are doing about that experience are completely entwined. We talk about IPA being experience close versus experience far to indicate that you can never get at pure experience. Theoretically, philosophically, it would always be said that even if you were as close to it as possible and you were the person, that your record of it will always be slightly after the actual happening. We are not the person who's actually having the experience. So what IPA is doing is it's saying we can't get at pure experience, but we want to get as close as we can as opposed to staying distant from it. So IPA was first developed in psychology. Now, that was an important part of it, that I was trying to articulate an approach that was within and connected to precedents within psychology. It's now widely used in psychology and beyond many disciplines and widely across the world. So what are the key features, components of IPA? So here I'm thinking of its theoretical underpinnings, and it has three primary ones: phenomenology, hermeneutics, and ideography. It's phenomenological in that what phenomenological philosophy is concerned about is engaging with lived experience. Husserl was the first to write systematically about phenomenological philosophy. And one of the statements that he's remembered for is that he was arguing that what we should be doing in terms of phenomenology is going back to the things themselves. And what he means by the things themselves there are the objects of experience and consciousness stripped as far as possible of filters which get in the way of those experiences being able to show themselves. So, for example, the argument would be that you would want to look at this experience without the normal apparatus of experimental psychology in terms of existing literature, hypotheses to be confirmed or disconfirmed, turned into variables, which then determine the way you look at the thing. From Husserl's perspective, that frame, that apparatus is getting in the way of the thing showing itself in its own terms. Of course, this is an ideal. It's not possible to do entirely, but that's a fundamental way of thinking in terms of phenomenological approaches. Now, for IPA, following Heidegger, who developed Husserl's phenomenology, this process is an interpretative one. For Heidegger, in order to do phenomenology, you needed to do interpretation. You want to allow the thing to show itself in its own terms, but in order to do that, you have to facilitate the process and you have to make sense of it. So it's not that we can just extract meanings, experiences from people's heads. We have to set up a situation which will allow the person to give us their account. And as they present it, we need to make sense of it. The interpretation involved here is very much from within. We're talking about local interpretation, local sense-making on the part of the researcher, as opposed to interpretation based on major theoretical premises that we're bringing to the work. I'd already alluded to the type of sense that IPA has in terms of participants making sense. So in fact, IPA invokes a double hermeneutic where it's argued that researchers are trying to make sense of participants trying to make sense of X. Both researcher and participant are in the business of doing interpretations, of making sense. And I think that's quite nice because it shows it as an alliance. It's not that researchers are drawing on some magical property out with human functioning. They're doing the same thing. Okay, they're doing it more formally and more systematically and probably for a longer time, but nonetheless, the sense making, the interpretation of the researcher draws on the same basic human skill set as participants are doing themselves. But at the same time, the researcher's sense making is always second order. We are dependent on the account of the sense making from the participant to do our sense making. Probably the most distinctive feature of IPA is its ideography. Most research is nomothetic. Most quantitative and qualitative research is nomothetic. I'm not saying all of it is, but most of it is, where the claims are made at a population or group level. So while there may be data collected from individuals, the analytic process involves a transformation so that one is making claims at a population or a group level, which make it difficult to make statements true of the individuals that you've collected the data from. An ideographic approach starts more cautiously and slowly and does an analysis of each case, each person case by case, so that for one time, the individual is the universe of inquiry. You look in detail at them, you look for patterns of meaning in that person, and you come to some working closure. You then move to the second person and work in the same way. And only after you've done that do you look for convergence and divergence across participants. That way of working will become clearer in a bit. So at its best, IPA is concerned, I've already alluded to this, sorry, I've got so many windows showing, just 1 minute. I've already said this, I think, that we can look at experience at multiple levels. Theoretically, one could be concerned with mundane experiences. At its best, IPA is looking at experiences of existential or experiential importance, those that matter to the person. Now, they can be crudely positive or negative experiences. A lot of IPA is concerned with things happening to the person that they didn't choose to, major health issues, for example. So something's happening to the person where they can't just carry on, pass it off. They actually need to take stock. What's happening? Why is this happening to me? How can I deal with it? But the experiences can be positive as well. Things that either are positive because there's agentic creation of that experience or generation of that experience, or because the thing that the experience that's happening, the person does feel good about. And then the other part of what makes good IPA is a concern with hot cognition versus cool cognition. What that's getting at is that when people are engaged in these experiences, they generate sense-making, and that sense-making is both cognitive and affective. So it's not a matter of the person saying, doing a cool cost benefit analysis, giving a score to a range of numbers for this thing that's happening to them. Actually, when they're thinking about what is going on, that thinking is emotionally laden. It really matters to the person. And that's why the hot cognition is important. Now, that it doesn't mean that the event or experience has to be only something that's happening now, that started recently. It could be an experience, an event that happened sometime in the past. The important thing is the engagement for the person. So it's still an experience because the person is still engaged in it. It's still generating hot cognition. Okay. So what type of questions is IPA suitable for? Here are some examples. What's the experience of moving job like during COVID-19? So that's clearly a newish, innovative type of research question that wouldn't have applied a number of years ago. So the what's at stake here is that there is a pandemic, the person has a pre-existing career trajectory. Well, what's the impact of COVID-19 on it? What does it mean to have a best friend? So this is not about testing theories of friendship human relationships. This is about trying to understand as closely as possible from the person's perspective what the friendship means to them, the way in which they conceptualize this person, and so on. How do people make sense of a positive genetic test result? There's a lot of there's increasing numbers of conditions for which genetic tests are available. This is a spin-off of the Human Genome Project. And just to talk about this one a little bit more, it's a project that it's an area that I've done quite a lot of research in. So here, what we're interested in is the participant sense making, not the clinicians. Genetics, academic genetics and clinical genetics are both very complex, and clinicians have a model of the way genetics works, and they have therapeutic intentions that they want to provide to participants. What's important from this perspective is what sense participants and patients make of it. How do they understand genetics? How do they understand what a genetic test and its information can provide? And the important thing that is often at or can be at odds with the clinician's understanding. So the clinician's understanding is very important, but here we're not testing whether the person has a correct understanding of what the clinician thinks. What we're trying to do is understand how the participant is making sense of this situation from their own point of view. Okay, what's involved in doing an IPA study? So you need to develop an experiential research question along the lines of those that I just showed, something that's interesting and important, hopefully to you and to the wider community. And then you need to find a willing group of participants to engage in a discussion with you. That's usually in the form of an interview. This is a time-consuming exercise. Normally we're talking to people for an hour or more. So you need to find people who are willing to give that time to talk to you. I mean, it's usually of no difficulty. People want to talk about things that matter to them. The way in which you talk, the way in which you engage them is absolutely critical. That involves skills that are really important, because the quality of the analysis that you can do in an IPA study is capped by the quality of the data that you get from participants. And two interviewers might have different skill sets, and one might elicit an account that's okay, it's of some interest, but not especially so, whereas the other person gets a much more in-depth, rich account from the participant. Then you analyze each case in turn, in detail. And importantly, after that, you turn your analysis into an interpretative account of the participant's experience that is available to the readership. It can be a technical readership, or it could be a broader readership. But the point is that you need to enable them to be able to see what it is that you're seeing in the accounts of your participants. And that account draws on detailed extracts from the participants and a full interpretative commentary from you. Okay, so I'm now going to hand over to Isabella, who will carry that story on and give us a more detail of the actual research process.
Thank you, Jonathan. I'm just going to share my screen. Oops. Sorry. Okay. So I'm going to talk about the book and how the book has been structured and the steps involved in the process that Jonathan has just described. And the way in the book, we really tackle those steps from a very practical point of view. And I'm going to do so using some examples. And these are the examples that we offer in the book as well. So you would be starting with designing your study. So you would be finding an open exploratory question about an experience that somehow has been or is important for your participants. And then from that, you would be determining the type of data to collect, which typically in IPA will be a semi-structured interview, or this is at least is the type of data gathering that we describe in the book. There are obviously other methods as well. And then you would go about sampling your participants and you would go about recruiting them. So sampling in IPA is usually samples are small and homogeneous. And then you would be collecting data from these people. And in order to do so, using a semi-structured interview, you would need an interview guide. So we discuss how to design an interview guide as well. And we do this using a small case study of a young woman called Susan, who traveled abroad when she was very young on her own for the first time. And that is the topic of our research. So this shows a portion of the interview guide that we used to interview Susan. And as you can see, there are some questions and there are some prompts. And this example is useful because it allows us to illustrate the types of questions that you might ask, the order in which you might be asking those questions, the type of prompts that you might use to encourage your participant to talk in case the question on its own is not enough, but also the types of probes that you might use, so the impromptu prompts that you might use in response to something that the participant has said. And the transcript of Susan's interview also allows us to discuss the interview dynamic and the value of having a guide and the type of decisions that you would need to take when designing such a guide. And the transcript also allows us to show the type of transcription that is suitable for analysis with IPA. So the next stage, once you have your transcript, would be to analyze the data. And as Jonathan said earlier, this would be done case by case. And although we break down the analysis process into four steps, I really would like to stress how, in fact, it is an iterative process. And we say this in the book as well. So the fact of breaking down step by step is not to be prescriptive, but is to facilitate understanding what the process is like for somebody who has never carried it out before. But the idea is actually you would be going back over these steps. So for instance, although you might be formulating experiential statements after having created your exploratory notes, it could be that during the clustering process, you find yourself wanting to revisit those experiential statements, to reword them, to adjust them in some manner. So the way of working that we suggest in the book is to have, as you can see in this example, the transcript at the center of a page, and then two columns on either side. The column on the right is the column where you would be including your exploratory notes, and then on the left you would be devising your experiential statements. So the process is to work through the transcript line by line with a very fine comb and capturing in the exploratory notes, which are the first thing that you would be doing, all your thoughts, your ideas, making comments, zooming in on specific words that you think might be relevant, asking questions, and really spending time with the transcript to sort of work through and start building ideas about what's going on in the transcript. And you would do this for the whole transcript. And then the next stage, you would return to the transcript, and using the notes as an input, you would be formulating experiential statements. So experiential statements are really pithy, interpretative summaries of what is happening in a specific portion of text. And in a transcript, you can have a number of experiential statements. Each sort of turn of phrase in the transcript will probably have its own experiential statement. And once you have gone through the transcript, identifying all the necessary experiential statements, you would be then ready to move on to the next stage, which is working with those experiential statements to try and create a sort of structure for what is actually happening within this case. So I personally like to work on paper. So for instance, I will then type these statements out and cut them up and sort of put them as pieces of paper on a table and work physically with moving them around and creating groupings. We're looking for connections. We're looking for ways in which the statements speak to each other, come together, or are in contrast with each other. And this clustering process is a process which often will take you back to a previous step, so adjusting the experiential statements, but eventually it will culminate and allow you to define the personal experiential themes, so to name the personal experiential themes of your participant. And this is an example of the output of the process, meaning you would have an intermediate phase where all the experiential statements have been clustered, but then eventually would build a table of personal experiential themes for that particular person. As you can see here, we have the themes above, you have the themes above, you have the experiential statements below there, but you also have here, which is very important, little snippets of quotes that connect to the experiential statements. And the reason for that is that it can be quite easy when you're interpreting, because you're being interpretive in devising your themes and in your experiential statements and eventually your themes. It can be quite easy to sort of move away from what the participant actually said. And having the quotes there forces you to come back and make sure that your interpretations are really grounded in the data. Also, this structure as it is going to be very useful for the next stage when you come round to eventually writing up your analysis. So ideally, If you have a single participant, the next step would be to write up the analysis, but normally you would have more than one participant. So the next step is actually doing a cross-case analysis. So if you've conducted this process for every single person that you have recruited and you have interviewed for every single participant in your study, you actually have a set of potentially quite different tables of personal experiential themes. So what happens during the cross-case analysis is that you look across these different tables and you start thinking in terms of similarities and differences between people, in terms of what might, if there are threads that somehow connect these participants together, if there are themes that are going across the group. Also, what might happen is that you might find yourself revisiting some of the cases in the light of what you're observing in new ones. So although each case has been definitely analyzed on its own right, when they come together in the cross-case analysis, you could find yourself rethinking, for instance, something of an earlier case in the light of what you have learned in the later cases. So this shows you an example of a table of group experiential themes. This is taken from a different study. This is a study on organ donation that we conducted a few years ago. And as you can see here, we have a sort of higher level theme, which is broken down into two lower level themes. So in this case, because we're talking about organ donation, we have a higher level themes, which is attitude to death and bodily continuity, which encompasses the varying ability to detach from the dead body and seeing organs as something of value. And within those sub-themes, you have the representation of those participants for whom that particular sub-theme was relevant. And they are represented through their words. So again, we have verbatim quotes from participants. And this becomes indispensable when we then move on to the next stage, which is writing up the study. And this again is an example taken from the paper on organ donation, directly from the paper. Now, obviously, these numbers along the side, we have put because to explain what's happening in each paragraph, but those wouldn't be in the original paper. But what you can see here is that the way we would be shifting from the group experiential themes to the actual write-up, and where the analytical process, in fact, is continuing, because it is only when you're writing up that you, in fact, are testing your table of themes, and you might need to adjust it to allow you to tell a coherent story of your data. And what you will be doing is probably in writing up, you would be sort of summarizing what's happening in a theme. And then at a very detailed level, discuss your interpretations in the light and tightly connected with the actual quotes from participants. So you might be zooming in on a specific word or a specific expression, or contrasting what different participants said on the same topic. So in the book, we have really tried for each stage of the analysis of an IPA project to give clear instructions based on clear examples, because we think that's really the best way of understanding what is happening, because sometimes the process can be complex. Obviously, a more experienced researcher might need to be a bit more flexible, but as it is quite step by step, and we think that is going to be quite useful for people particularly for people approaching IPA for the first time or returning to IPA after some time. And so I think I'm just going to pass over to Jonathan, who I think would like to add one thing. Your side.
Thank you. Can I check that the line's okay? It went a bit out when Isabella was talking. Can people hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you.
All right. Okay, yeah, I just want to add one short note. I go to the end of my slides, just about the nature of the terminology. So if you are new to IPA, this is not so meaningful. If you are already familiar with IPA, you may have noticed a bit of change of terminology in the way that Isabella was speaking. So I just wanted to speak to that a little bit. A number of us as senior IPA researchers have recently been taking stock on the terminology that's used. There are various projects that led that to happen. And we thought it was appropriate to make some changes. What we wanted to do was to make sure that the key terms we're using reflect more precisely what they're doing. So we're not suggesting a change to the practice of doing the IPA. We're just suggesting some refinement, some finessing of the actual terminology. And those changes are reflected in the book and were reflected in Isabella's slides. So to give you the nub of this, in the old terminology, broadly, when going through the analysis, you moved from, on a single case, writing exploratory notes. They were then transformed into emergent themes. And then those were clusters of those produced superordinate themes. So what we've done is in the new parlance, the new terminology, exploratory notes, exploratory comments hasn't changed. It's what you do next. So Isabella showed the way in which in one margin, we construct experiential statements, which are applying to that particular part of the text. And that's why, so that's the new terminology that we're using. We think that's better. And it's only after you have a series of experiential statements that you look for a patterning of those, and then you get a theme, which is a personal experiential theme. We're clarifying that terminology to make it very specific, which is based on a collection of experiential statements. There's more to it, but that's the heart of it. The book explains it thoroughly. What's the implication for you? If you're new to IPA, I don't think it has any really. We would encourage you to use this new terminology, which we've tried out with various people and they like it. If you're already doing IPA, or if you're in the middle of your study, then you need to think about what you do. You might, I'm easy about this. You could either stick with your old terminology, or you could modify it. You should just be clear about it. We're expecting that for the next few years, there will be a time where both of these sets of terminology are being used in parallel, or being used by different people. Okay, I'll finish there.